Let's talk about multiple dispatch in this episode. It's also known as multi-methods or multi-method dispatch. I've seen it called as well. And we'll dig into what it is, how it differs from single dispatch, and we'll show an example with virtual, and we'll show an example with variant. But before we do any of those things, I want to remind you that my name is Jason Turner. I'm available for code reviews and on-site training, particularly on-site training. You should have me out to your organization. This episode is sponsored by Perforce. Is your team under pressure to deliver high-quality software faster? Is lowering cost and increasing speed to market a priority? With the right static analysis tools, you can ensure the quality, security, and compliance of your code without slowing down development. You'll get accurate diagnostics, ensure your code complies with the latest industry standards, and find bugs earlier in the development cycle. See which tools are right for you. Follow the link below to request a free static code analyzer trial. Let's read this technical description here from Wikipedia since I already had it up. Multiple dispatch or multi-methods is a feature of some programming languages in which a function or method can be dynamically dispatched based on the runtime, dynamic, type, or in the more general case, some other attribute of more than one of its arguments. This is a generalization of single dispatch polymorphism where a function or a method call is dynamically dispatched based on the derived type of the object on which the method has been called. Multiple dispatch routes the dynamic dispatch to the implementing function or method using the combined characteristics of one or more arguments. I feel like some of the examples that we're going to cover in this episode are going to end up kind of looking like pattern matching, and you'll see what I mean in a minute. And I'm going to leave this variant visitor example up here because we're going to kind of want that visitor as well in just a moment. Let's go ahead and do a basic polymorphic kind of thing. And I'm just going to copy and paste my example in here. Let's just go ahead and throw out a space object thing. I have my proper virtual destructor here because I am going to have some polymorphic behavior. And here is your reminder that we can now in C++ have constexpr virtual member functions. And I've decorated this thing with basically as many things as it can possibly have. So please enjoy your no discard virtual constexpr string view get name const no accept member function. Although in reality, when I am personally writing code like this, I'm going to start to prefer trailing return types, even if you don't like them in other cases. I feel like gives you a little bit more clarity to the nature of the function by the time you have the virtual constexpr and all the things sprinkled about. So if I have a function, some sort of factory function here, and I ask it to give me back a space object, I have no idea what type of object that is. And I can't execute this code now because I'm calling a function that hasn't been defined, even though it has been declared. See, undefined reference, we cannot link into an executable here. This is single dispatch here. When I call space obj arrow get name, I don't know which member function ultimately I'm going to be calling. I might be calling the asteroid get name, or I might be calling the craft get name. What I know that I can't possibly be calling is the space object get name because that is a pure virtual member function and therefore it can't be called. That's single dispatch. I don't know what's going to be called here, but it is called based on the runtime type of the thing. Say I have something that is going to give me a vector of unique pointers of space objects, and I would like to process collisions between them. Like if two craft collide, then I want something to happen. If two asteroids collide, I want something different to happen. If a craft collides with an asteroid, then I want something else to happen. And I will say, just for the record, that these examples are largely borrowed from that Wikipedia page that I already mentioned, but they have been modified a bit to work specifically within C++. I can't call this collide function. If I call this, all I have is two different space objects. I don't have the way of knowing if it's a craft or an asteroid. So to actually do this, I would have to write out each of the four cases, and it would become rather tedious. It would have to be something like, as you can see, first of all, I can't believe that I actually took the effort to type all of that out. That was very annoying. But this is tedious and error prone. If you were watching, although I'm sure I sped it up quite a bit, I probably had things wrong at several points in this process. If I had accidentally done a copy paste error and had object craft, other craft, and then object craft, other craft again on line 49, things would have gone poorly. So this is manual, this is tedious. I could probably have written my own multi-method dispatch thing that attempts to dynamic cast each of these objects, but really the standard library already has a tool for this. Now, if I have my get objects, instead of returning a unique pointer to a space object, I have it return a variant of craft and asteroid, and then I can remove all of that, and I can do this visit behavior, but with standard visit, I can visit on multiple different things at a time. Now, I'm also no longer dealing with pointers, and I'm no longer dealing with heap allocations. And just for the record, the work that the compiler and the runtime has to do with variant is very, very similar to a virtual member function call. So we're not really making a performance trade-off here, except that we do get to avoid having to dynamically allocate these things. It's definitely several different trade-offs, but I want to show you the possibilities. Okay, I'm going to show you a couple of different things here before I move on. Now, the first is that I have intentionally left out one of the possible pairings. I've left out the craft and asteroid pairing, and I'm now going to get this super complicated and as painful as possible to understand compiler error. You're going to read this all day long and not know what it means. And if we add that last possible pairing, then that error should go away. Well, I had the parameter passed to this function, still expecting a polymorphic type, but let's go ahead and comment out one of these overloads so that you can still see that there's going to be a difficult to understand error. Yes, here we go. So good luck trying to figure out why this code didn't compile in this particular case. So this is something, and this is what I was saying, this kind of starts to look like pattern matching. I'm saying if I have a craft and a craft to do X, if I have an asteroid do Y, etc. But I do have this kind of fundamental problem of, now where do I put the actual collision test to see if these two objects collided with each other, because I still have to unpack them. I can't rely on this polymorphic thing anymore. I still have to look at the runtime type information for this. So we can still get the same behavior without this visitor thing if I were to quite simply do this. There you have it. I am using this to call the collide function, but I basically let template magic inside of standard visit unpack for me the two types of these things, and then I call the correct function, and it's a runtime decision that's made, but all of the potential types have to be known at compile time in this particular case. Well, I don't know. I hope you found this interesting. And if you didn't know anything about multi-method dispatch before, maybe you've had a use case similar to this, but didn't know that there was a potential solution for it. And just as an aside, my scripting language, ChiScript, always worked on the most derived type of the thing, and it could kind of naturally do multi-method dispatch, although I rarely found a use case for it, and I'm not necessarily suggesting that you go check out ChiScript today. But there have been several efforts to add this kind of thing, and like I said, pattern matching would give us similar behavior in C++. So look into those as well, and leave a comment if this has inspired or reminded you of anything that you've worked on before. And thank you for watching this episode of C++ Weekly.